The Linux Action Show is created by Jupiter Broadcasting. It's sponsored by Ting. Go to last.ting.com to save off your first device or plan. And DigitalOcean. Go to DigitalOcean.com and use the promo code Here's the Thing, all one word like you're slurring it, and spin up your own Linux rig for free. And Linux Academy. Go to linuxacademy.com/unplugged and invest in your mind while saving some money. Welcome to Linux Action Show, episode 431. My name is Chris.
My name is Noah.
Hello there, Noah. Guess what? We got a big show this week, something we've wanted to do for a long time. You probably heard us say it 100 times over the last few years. Now, we're actually going to make good on it. Every now and then we toss in the, we'll follow up on this and tell you how it's gone with X during a review or when we're trying something out. And this week, we're going to answer the chat room's live questions and follow up on the items that we meant to. We also have a list of our own, things like how we're getting along with own cloud still, our Android set-top boxes. I've got a Mint 18 review I want to follow up on, as well as a handful of other questions that have come in over Twitter, and like I said, the live IRC. So this week, we make good and we follow up on the things that we've talked about for a long time on the show and tell you where they stand many months later. And if you think about it, isn't that often really the review you want? Is not with something's like the first week you've had it, but 6 months into it? We try to walk that line as much as possible, but once you really have something for a while, you get a feel for it. So we'll follow up. Plus, in the news segment, did you hear the rumors? Google's developing an entirely new operating system that could compete with Linux and Android. And the more we find out, the more fascinating it sounds. We'll tell you what we know so far. A huge, huge conversion to Linux and LibreOffice, which I hopefully will take off like wildfire. And something that's being claimed as a Linux malware epidemic, but actually has nothing to do with Linux. It's just ridiculous. We'll share what's going on there. And then last but not least, one of our favorite tools has just been open source. But before all of that, Noah, you know what we've got?
I believe we have... Well, what do we have?
The picks! We have the picks! We have the picks, right, yeah. We also have some feedback later on, a video edition, but let's get into those picks. This Runs Linux Picks, a good one. This one came in also by our subreddit. That's two in a week. I love it. Super Smith Foo wrote in and said, this one that, how could I deny this? This black hole creating laboratory machine at the University of Nottingham runs Linux. It legitimately creates black holes, although not the kind that destroy the universe, but more like the principles of black holes and then observe them. I'll play a little bit of the clip and then we'll describe
it. So we are in the black hole laboratory. What you're looking at, that's an analog rotating black hole.
So they have created like a dye and some fluids, and then they spin it and it creates a black hole using some of the similar physics. And that's all interesting.
We fill up the space in here in the back. We put water in there, and then we also put what's called fluorescent dye. Makes your fingers dirty. It's actually sort of orangey, but then it takes a blue part of the spectrum of the light and converts blue into green.
And now, why do they need to convert blue into green? What is the point of all of that? Well, friends, if you jump ahead in the video, which your friendly Linux Action Show will, you'll find out where the Linux comes in to do a little image processing.
100 images per second. The first step you need to do, you take a series of images to find out which points corresponds to the same physical point in these two images. And you look at a correlation. And it works exactly in the way, if you wish, if you have your eyes, you take from everything two images, but your brain converts it into one. So this is what we do. And with this information, we can reconstruct the free surface. Here on the screen, you see the reconstructed image.
This is a Unity app. This is a GTK app running under Ubuntu Unity Desktop. And one of the things that's interesting is the computer takes the surface and breaks it up into millions of pieces of data. It essentially looks like Mountain Dew in the tub, but the computer is able to analyze in a really impressive way and get tons of data on how black holes are formed and pull matter into them.
It's a little bit better than our eyes, because I get exact amplitudes here. You see, you can see all the waves coming in, and you can see how these waves scatter here and how they get deformed.
There you go, Noah. Look at that. Freaking Linux is being used to create and document how black holes form. All right. That's a good one.
In a place in the scientific space, I think that Linux has kind of become the de facto standard. And actually, it's more awkward not to see Linux in that space than it is to see Linux in that space.
I like that. Let's go with that. I like it. So thank you to Super Miss Foo, or however it's pronounced, for submitting that to linuxactionshow.reddit.com. Linux.com. You know, I have lots of things that run Linux up at DigitalOcean, our first sponsor on the Linux Action Show. Use the promo code Here's the Thing, all one word like you're slurring it, and you'll get a $10 credit at DigitalOcean. They have a great UI to manage all of this. And I don't mean it's a great UI for like a website. I mean it's a great UI for any kind of virtualization platform. It's really kind of impressive what they've done because they took the nitty-gritty of all the stuff you don't have time to do, like go find tier one bandwidth in data centers all over the world and create massive multi-year huge contracts, deploy systems stacked full of SSD drives, get Linux on them, start up KVM, connect them to the best possible data connections at those data centers. All of that work, that in itself is an unbelievable feat, especially DigitalOcean got in on SSDs way early before any of the other hosting providers did, and they're still playing catch up. But they brought it all together with that beautiful meat sandwich that is their interface. They've got a great API too, well documented. But that interface, it's just damn good for any kind of workload like this. You can deploy entire Linux stacks with all the apps you need installed, free BSD if you're a masochist, and they also even have Fedora for some reason. I don't know why, but they'll have Debian and Ubuntu as well, and CoreOS. And when you're over there, take a look around and do a little poking. See what it's like to have SSD performance up on a droplet. See what the deployment process is, the backup process, the team support, the high availability storage, the API with tons of good open source apps already built. Just use that promo code, Here's the Thing, you get a $10 credit. You can try it out for quite a while for free, either 2 months with the $5 droplet, or if you just use it, you know, sparingly. When you're trying something out with the hourly pricing, it's ridiculous. And if you're looking at transitioning from OwnCloud to NextCloud, we'll be talking about that coming up in the episode. There's a thread over there you can check out. They have new block storage as well. And something else I'm seeing is a huge, huge buildup around the community. Not only does DigitalOcean sponsor a bunch of great Linux projects and give them free hosting, but this is something I've been seeing. Have you seen this button before, Noah? This is at the Kauai open source web client for XMPP. Uh-huh. This is like a really nice open source webmail client. And it's a web front end to XMPP, really mm-hmm. sharp, and they have a one-click deployment on DigitalOcean button right there. Isn't that nice?
You know, I bet that's probably possible because of their API, right?
So absolutely.
They design this website and they say, well, here's our project. Then we click this button and it sends the little API magic voodoo back over to DigitalOcean, spins this droplet up.
Yeah, Kiowa. Kiowa, which is just an example. There's tons of really, there's tons of good code already written. If you go to the community section of their website and you dig around over in projects, you'll get a little picture of that. You'll really kind of just, actually, probably be easier to search or just go. I mean, there's a lot in there. Tons of good stuff. DigitalOcean's really, if you need a computer to do something for you and you don't even necessarily need a GUI, although there's actually ways to do that too, you could set up a machine or build a machine. But when you can spin up a droplet for $5 and it's unbelievably fast with a great connection, there's nothing that beats it. I just a couple of weeks ago wanted to try out some wiki software that needed MySQL, Apache, and PHP. And I just don't have those installed on my daily driver laptop. And I don't mind it. If I'm gonna use that wiki, I'll load them and use them locally. But before I try it, I just spun up a DigitalOcean droplet for like 2 minutes. And deployed the entire LAMP stack, and then dropped the wiki on there. And within another minute, I knew I was done with it. Never trashed up my system. Less than, you know, just pennies on the dollar to do that. And great connection and performance. And what's great about that is, you could also move something like that very easily into production. You secure it properly, and then push the button, and you're in production. It's a really nice service. DigitalOcean.com, and go check out all the open source code in their community section, and use our promo code, Here's the Thing, at DigitalOcean.com. All right, Noah. Desktop picks and spotlights. No, it wasn't that web-based XMPP. It is, you ready for this? LSyncD. Oh, yeah.
LSyncD. What is LSyncD and what does it do?
Oh, buddy. It synchronizes local directories with remote targets. And here's how it does it. LSyncD watches a local directory tree event and monitors it through IO Notify or FS events. It then aggregates and combines events every few seconds and then spawns up a sync and synchronizes the changes. So it uses rsync for really fancy synchronization. Mm-hmm. So it's lightweight. It works great in a mirror situation or copying data around, does not require new file systems or block devices, does not hamper any local file system performance. It's rsync and SSH combined with fine-grained monitoring and coalescing of file system events to initiate and trigger an rsync over SSH or something like that based on file system actions. So how I would use this myself is, say I have a machine here at the studio that's doing big bulk ISO downloads for me. There's something I want to review. I see it at home at Lady Jupe's. I'm on a MiFi connection. I'm not going to download an ISO on a MiFi connection. That's nuts. It would just totally eat up the whole connection. So right. what I've thought about doing often is having something that would download here at the studio, and then when it's done, then something triggers the sync event that moves it from my system here at the studio to my system at home in one big shot. Just burst it to me. And I could do that just at night, or I could do it based on changes during the day. And that's where this comes in. So lsyncd is live syncing and mirroring based on file system changes using tools that we already love, just a little bit extra on top. So I think it's pretty nice. I think it'd be great too for keeping data synchronized between two machines. It's in my case, it's like a poor man's DRBD, which DRDB does sort of the same thing, but at the block level when blocks change, whereas this is sitting up at the rsync file system level, so I could have extended for here, ZFS there, don't need to worry about that, don't have to create new block devices, don't have to change mount points, that kind of stuff. Lsyncd, Noah. Take That's rsync awesome. And make it better. I just came up with that, they can run with it. That's theirs. All right, so last week I did the same thing, super heavy command line pick. So we flip over to the other side for the spotlight, and we go with something a little open sourcey, a little fresh and new, and it could be right up your alley. You know what you don't like, Noah? You don't like those damn hosted proprietary services that might just fly by night and go away one day.
That is correct.
Right? You won't buy a Roku.
I won't install Dropbox on my laptop.
You won't install Dropbox on your laptop like an animal. And you sure as hell ain't ever going to be caught dead sharing your home videos or something like that, you know, something cute the kids do with the family over that damn YouTube, right? Not gonna happen. So,
I know what that is.
This is where Cumulus Clips comes in. It's a free and open source video CMS. What? That's right. It's a video sharing script, essentially, that allows you to start your own video website. It's free and easy to use. You essentially create a YouTube knockoff. It's a video sharing product that uses HTML5 video, so it works on iOS and Android devices, because that's the only thing Noah uses, or Internet Explorer.
I use Edge. I've been recently getting into Edge lately,
but
my Bing searches on my Surface with Windows 10.
Yeah, So this is just a super basic example here, but it analyzes a directory, and it's generated this video streaming of here's the Man of Steel preview, and it's got comments, it's got thumbs up, it's freaking, it's like YouTube 3 years ago. It's like YouTube 3-4 years ago without ads that you build yourself. It's an open source CMS system for doing this. So it generates
you can host it yourself and whatnot, right?
Huh?
It's you can host it yourself.
Yeah, Noah, that's the point, man.
Well, okay,
that's the entire.
It's a lead question. So I'm gonna follow it up.
All right.
When you go to set this up, is it something that I have to install a bunch of different components to make it work, or is it like one of those? Is it like a single package that I install and boom, now I have this video service?
Yes, both of those things are true.
So you install it and boom, you have a video service, but you have to have a lot of other stuff running beforehand.
Yes.
Okay.
And also, you can host it on their own platform, which I'm sure you were going to ask me about next, right?
I was, yeah. Can I just pay a monthly fee and have them host
it? Sure, you could, but then why? What's the whole point, Noah? Jeez,
figure it out. I wasn't going to ask, but then you prompted me.
Chatroom thinks that Cumulus Clips is a play on maybe your own porn hosting platform. Seems like it'd make a good market, actually. There should be an open platform for hosting porn. Cumulus, C-U-M-U, I don't know. Anyways.
Cumulus?
That's what I think, but they think it's not. They're being dirty in the chat room. Either way, it actually seems like legitimately a possible use case for this software. However, I was more thinking you got your own video how-to series, four-part, five-part video series. You got family clips of the kids playing in the pool or something like that, and you just want to share with family and you don't want to put it on Facebook or YouTube. That's where this guy comes in. That self-hosting thing.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's where you're going to put all those red shirt videos.
Yeah, exactly. And it is up on the code, I believe, is up on the GitHubs. But you know what? I'm going to be fully honest with you. This is not for me. I have not installed this. I have no interest in this. Honestly, I would either just use Dropbox and just link people to a video if I want to share privately, or I would just throw it up on an HTTP directory and just link people to that, and then it would just play in their browser. But this is out there if you guys want to make your own porn site or you want to host pictures or videos of the family or something like that. So
what? What?
Nothing. Everything works great on YouTube. We've not had any problems with YouTube.
Also,
great. We never ever get taken down because of content protection, and this wouldn't fundamentally solve that problem. Just saying.
Well, you know, if we ever have to pivot, as they say in the industry, and become a porn network, now we know what our back-end infrastructure will be. Yeah. So that problem solved.
Okay, good. Yeah. We got the shirt and we got the infrastructure.
Yeah. All right. You know, speaking of swag, I don't know. JupiterBroadcasting.com/stickers. We've got pictures and stickers. What? We got pictures on stickers that you can put on your laptop or whatever. Hey, Noah, do you have that Microsoft thing nearby that you could show gratuitously? Do you have some? That's not it, Noah. There it is. I see two Jupiter Broadcasting stickers on there. Yeah, very nice.
I've got my face.
Although, I think above your face, directly above your face in the center, maybe below the webcam, you should put the last logo.
Yeah, that would go really good.
Yeah,
right,
and
there.
Then that would
the last logo. Well,
because there's too much. Otherwise, dude, it's you need to de-Microsoft that a little bit more.
Yeah, yeah. Well, there's you can't really tell. I put it over the Windows logo at the back, right?
So I know.
You
can't see that. Yeah, I know you did. I know that was a good move. That was a good move. If you have some shame you need to hide, JupiterBroadcasting.com/stickers. The last logo. All the stickers are vinyl. We got a brand new Linux Unplugged one up there. The new TechSnap logo is posted. I can't believe the colors on that BSD Now sticker. And of course, Noah switched me to Linux as well as the generic Jupiter Broadcasting sticker that makes anything, including your Tesla, look better. JupiterBroadcasting.com. No,
that's
it. Yeah. Okay. But I would, if somebody did, they should tweet that to me because that would make my whole week.
Okay, I might have an in on you. I might have an in for you.
Yeah?
Yeah, I might have. May be able to get a Jupiter Broadcast.
We sent Leo Laporte, you know, got a Tesla.
Oh,
and
yeah?
We sent him a Linux Action Show sticker, but he put it on his laptop. That's crazy. Yeah, that's why. A laptop? What the? So anyways, if you want to put it on your Tesla and take it back, that's fine. JupiterBroadcasting.com/stickers. Or if you want to put it on your laptop like Noah and Leo, that's fine. I actually just put a couple more on my laptop this weekend. So there you go. It's kind of a fun place, and we have some limited supply stickers up there as well. I'm still talking about stickers. Let's get out of here. Let's go do the news.
Hey, it's the news, and this episode is brought to you by
Ting.com, Noah. Jeez, I can't believe you haven't figured that out yet. Go to last.ting.com and save off your first device. Ting's mobile, that really makes sense. I mean, jeez. Oh my gosh, guys. So the other wireless carriers, they got gimmicks up the wazoo. They're trying to nickel and dime you for every single thing. They got an idea for everything. But here's how Ting works. It's so simple. You pay for what you use. No contract, no early termination. It's $6 for a line. And that's it. They've got like really, really great phones to pick from, or you can just bring your own. Like, it's not a big deal, and there's CDMA or GSM to choose from, so the options are pretty wide. You're just going to want to double check on their BYOD page. I think, Noah, you're probably like, what? Are you like all in on GSM now? You're like all in on GSM.
In fact, not only am I so all in on GSM, I had a discussion with one of my buddies that understands the very technical side of GSM and CDMA.
Yeah, yeah.
He's like, he can't stand GSM. But you used to be that guy too.
You were kind of that guy before,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, kind of.
Not
guess
like strong, but like a little bit.
I guess
yeah.
a little bit, but I was just like, if I have the two choices, I'll go with CDMA because I know it's a better choice. But as far as he's concerned, using a GSM phone is like writing your password on your shirt and walking around.
Yeah.
You know, but I was sitting with him and another buddy of mine who's like completely technically illiterate, and we're sitting in the car and we're driving, and my other friend, I was showing him my GSM phone, and he had switched to Ting, and he's on GSM now. He's switching his wife over, and of course, third guy over here is freaking out, and he's like, it's so insecure. And he's like, listen, I don't even care. It is so convenient to be able to hand my wife my phone. She puts her SIM card in. Now it's her phone. Then she hands it back, and I put my SIM card in. Now it's my phone.
You know,
and like DEFCON, do you know how valuable that was to buy a GSM phone from Amazon? And I stuck the SIM card in, and boom, it's activated. I got done, threw the SIM card out, threw the phone away, and I was done.
I'm gonna admit it right now. I took an old Nexus device, and I reactivated it on Ting for 1 month so Dylan could play Pokemon Go a little bit. And it was like, why not? It's like, six, that's fine. It's easy, right? And I had the device. Yeah. But I wanted to back up for a second, because I want to talk about how I kind of use Ting. And it's both one part challenge to myself personally, but also it's just kind of savvy. You're touching on like the GSM stuff. I really kind of treat the cellular network as like my backup option.
Right.
And I
would
much prefer to do like, I would much prefer to do Wi-Fi or something like that and use the data network even before I actually use the cellular network. And that for me, as not only do I take that on as a personal challenge from a data conservation standpoint, but I just take it on as like a, I don't really want to do driving and talking anyway. So it's kind of like my policy. Don't call Chris while he's driving. So it also works that way.
Your policies don't call Chris ever for any reason.
Yeah, that's true. And and really, that makes it so that my bill, it's often even for like three devices, it's like $35 or something like that. It's incredible. And they have really good customer service. You get to talk to a human being. They've recently lowered their data rates, too. They have more information about that on their blog. And you can get $25 off your first device, which is unlocked and contract-free. Or you can bring your own device and get a $25 credit, which is probably going to pay for a huge part of your first bill, if not the entire thing. You just start by going to last.ting.com. Last.ting.com. You can also check them out on Twitter and other places and get a $25 credit. Thanks to Ting for sponsoring the Linux Action Show. All right, so there is a rumor of brewing. And it looks like this could be legit, too. I actually think this is probably happening. It's called Fuchsia. And it's a new open source operating system by Google, and it looks like it could compete with Linux and Android. I don't know how much you've heard at this point, Noah, but I've got a couple of bits here that it's all kind of rumors right now. But you can already find bits of it up on Google's GitHub repositories. At the moment, it doesn't include any source code, but we have a bunch of different like little pieces of bits of information that we can find out. It looks like the kernel is designed to interact with the OS via object handles. And there's some documentation they've dug through. The operating system is most notably intended to be used by consumer devices, such as IRC devices, as its IRC channel notes that it's currently boots on Intel NUX. And also, it looks like it'll be working on the Raspberry Pi 3 soon, and they have work in there for ARM devices. Android Police has the most comprehensive write-up, which we have linked in the show notes, where they talk a little bit about the kernel. And this is where it gets really fascinating. They say it uses a little kernel project, just like the Linux and Android kernel. The Magenta kernel powers larger Fuchsia operating system. Magenta is being designed as a competitor to commercial embedded OSs, such as FreeRTOS and ThreadX. However, Magenta is designed to scale much better, enabling Magenta to work on embedded devices, smartphones, and desktop computers. It improves upon its little kernel base by adding first-class user mode support, and it has a capability-based security model, which is a lot like how Android 6.0 permissions work. It looks like Google is using Flutter for the user interface, Dart for the primary programming language, and the icing on the cake is Escher, I'm not sure, which is the video renderer that supports light diffusion, soft shadows, and other visual effects with OpenGL or Vulkan under the hood. Shadows and subtle color reflections are key components of material design. They say that they know it has support for both 32 and 64-bit ARM CPUs, as well as some reports of, like I said earlier, it already running on some NUCs. So Fuchsia is their Internet of Things OS, some people are speculating. Magenta is the kernel, which is based on little kernel. So you have Fuchsia and Magenta. And it's not really clear if this will eventually replace Android, if this is going to work alongside Android, something like for the Chromecast type devices, or if it's really meant for like even desktops with, you know, early NUC support. Mm-hmm. Kind of could hint that way. Well, what are your initial reactions to Google creating what essentially at some level would be a Linux competitor?
On a small scale, I don't even trust. I have a hard time trusting Google with my calendar and my phone contacts and my email, let alone anything else, any actual valuable data. If Google is going to make an operating system, the mere fact that Google is making the operating system is prima facie evidence that I don't really want to trust it. And it's not because I think that Google is some bad, evil company that wants to do evil things. It's just that their business model relies on them exploiting my private information to make their money. And that's always been their business model. There's nothing wrong with making your money that way as long as you're upfront with your customers about it. But that right there prevents me from actually ever wanting to put any private or private secret data on that device. And so then it relegates itself to a public use kind of device where I might use it to check my email or might use it for, you know, browsing the web or something, but I'd never really use it for anything.
Shift context here. It's not for you. Think of it more like something that, you know, Google works with its OEMs, it works with its partners, and now all of a sudden it's showing up on Google connected devices. So picture it, Noah. It's 2017, late 2017, Christmas 2017, maybe it's spring 2018. And the Google little home thing that's like their Alexa competitor has shipped. And now you want to have a ecosystem of Google-supported devices that you can talk to your little Google assistant and say, turn on the lights in room 2. Activate the coffee pot in the kitchen. And all of these will be connected by other little Internet of Things devices.
Sorry, we'll get to the coffee pot in a second, and we'll get to the lights. Right now, you have to download this upgrade, and that will take 30 minutes, and then we'll be able to turn your lights on and start your coffee.
But Google, even if Google just used it for itself, this could be something that is taking market share from Linux.
Maybe. What market share are they going to grab with this operating system that they haven't already grabbed with Chrome OS?
I think maybe the embedded stuff more so less laptop stuff.
So
more.
part of the reason that Linux succeeds so well in the embedded devices is because you have people that start out with the project infancy on things like the Raspberry Pi and stuff like that, and that it's not really designed for production stuff, but they're playing with it and getting all the code written and entering into that ecosystem on Debian to begin with. So then when they go to larger projects and when they go to bigger embedded devices, they stick with that infrastructure because that's what they know. So in order for Google to be successful, I think, in the embedded side, more so that in a way that they're not already successful with Android, in the way that they're not already successful, what you'd have to do is you'd have to start attacking or penetrating that entry level part of the market.
Yeah, it's really hard to know at this time what market they're going after. I was asking you because what I wanted to say about it is, mm-hmm. I say bring it. Every time somebody goes up against Linux, eventually it seems like Linux dominates that space. Even slowly, I think one day it'll get there on the desktop. But if you look at the server market, you look at the embedded market, Linux really has a lot of momentum here. So if anything could happen, if another competitor could come around, I think it would probably be good. I think some competition, somebody that's kind of showing us up in a few spots, maybe does a few things better, could
I'll
be good.
I'll tell you one thing. I'll tell you someplace Google could pull ahead here. I was on Pocket Cast the other day, and there was a podcast that I was listening to, and I type in the name of the podcast, it pops up, I click on it, I click subscribe, now it's coming to my phone. And I went to do the same thing on an entirely different system, but I had to manually enter in the feed URL, right? And because Pocket Cast doesn't expose that to me, I had no way of getting that information into this other application. And so basically, I was relying on the magic of Pocket Casts to make that all happen for me. And as long as I was using that ecosystem, I didn't really notice that it wasn't working. Now, typically in the embedded market, we have a lot of different devices and projects and so on and so forth that run all these different systems, but you kind of have to understand how they work, and you're writing your code to perform a specific action. You have to kind of understand that if you're going to make that work. Where Google could pull ahead is if they came out with one operating system that, like you said, it talks to everything automatically and it figures everything out automatically. And so when Honeywell comes out with their new thermostat, it automatically talks to this operating system, stuff like that and that's great. And they could attack a market, but it's always going to keep people like me. And frankly, it's going to keep anyone in serious production, anyone that's building actual embedded devices, it's going to keep them off of it because they don't want to rely on magic scripts. Mm. They want to rely on understanding how that stuff works and they want to build that stuff themselves.
Yeah, I think you're probably right. All right then. Well said. We'll move right along. So this is a pretty big win for LibreOffice and for Linux. The Lithuania police are switching to LibreOffice and Linux desktops. The police force in Lithuania has switched to using LibreOffice, as you know, the free and open source office suite and productivity tools. They're doing it on 8,000 workstations, and they're using it on Ubuntu Linux. They say savings were the main motive for the switch to LibreOffice, the police confirms in an email to the European Commission's Open Source Observatory. The switch saves the police €1 million. I don't know, they don't say how often, but I'm going to imagine it probably is more than once, especially if you have to re-license things. Overall, they plan to use LibreOffice on 100,000 desktop workstations and save 26 to 29 million once the Ministry of Defense moves over. Jesus.
Wow.
there are some big steps coming up. Labor Office is going to get some huge users. That's great. And the police force is testing the use of Ubuntu Linux. I mean, that's two big wins. And I love hearing about it in the public sector. You've got it. As somebody like you, Noah, who loves taxes and loves paying his taxes.
Yeah. Oh, that's my favorite thing. I'm a red-blooded American. I love paying 40% of my money to the government.
I don't know. I guess I feel like because I've done this show for so long, I've said this so many times. But if you haven't watched a while, I think it's not just about the cost savings. And that's why these stories are important. It's so much more about so these people that are working in public positions are being paid for by the people. And what they are creating is on the people's behalf. And it shouldn't be locked up in a format that may not be accessible by the people 30 years from now. Because the types of crap and mundane stuff that all of us don't want to think about, that government employees diligently work on day in and day out, that stuff, governments, like 30 years is not a... That's a short window of time for governments. Having this stuff available for future generations is vitally important. And it's not something a lot of governments thought in the 80s and 90s and the 2000s as we began making these transitions. We didn't put a lot of thinking into longevity, file versions 10, 20, 30, 40 years down the road. Now here we are 20, 30 years down the road, and it's starting to hurt. And so as soon as we can move some of these places over to ODF or LibreOffice or even hell, OpenOffice or whatever.
I was working at a which shall remain nameless government entity. We were doing some contract work out there, and the software that they have only runs on DOS. And so they have a bunch. And you believe this? There's a company that exists for manufacturing computers to run antiquated operating systems like DOS and 95, so that you can continue to run the software. And that's what they're having to do because it's apparently millions of dollars to move all of this.
They probably still sell dot matrix printers and modems too.
You know, I don't even think they print out of the system, but the point is that there isn't a lot of thought given to longevity for sure, and so that's something that should be addressed. But even aside from that, even aside from the it's my tax dollars and so we want to spend them efficiently and stuff like that, even if it was a private business, there's still the concept of vendor lock-in, which doesn't matter if you're a government or a private business or whatever. It's just a good thing not to fall into, right?
Yeah, that's a good point. Even for a regular old mom and pop. Okay, so this next story grinds my gears, and I wanted to talk about it with you guys because I like the Register, so, you know, they wanted a good headline. But this is some real crap. Linux malware, it says? That'll never happen. Okay, just this once. And then the subline. Nasty malware targets badly secured Redis servers and turns them into coin mining monsters. Well, wait, what? Now, is it a Redis issue or is it a Linux issue? So this is coming from Dr. Webb. That's where they're getting the report from. And the security firm says that it's linux.lady.1, and it's a Trojan that does the following things. All right, so you ready for this Linux malware Trojan? It collects information about the infected computer and transfers it to command and control server. It downloads and launches the cryptocurrency mining utility and attacks other computers on the network in order to install its own copy of them. Is it doing CPU mining? Give me a break. It says, here's the issue, and this is the write-up. The good news is that while the Trojan targets Linux systems, okay, it doesn't rely on a Linux flaw to run. No flaw in Linux, no issue in Linux. The problem is instead with the Redis database software requiring a password or not requiring a password for connections by default.
Darn it, Linux.
So it seems like this could happen on BSD or Windows too.
Darn it, Linux.
I know. And the whole thing... The whole thing is
junk.
The whole thing is skewed towards Linux malware, and this is
software malware, not Linux malware, and really software vulnerability,
misconfiguration,
not Linux vulnerability.
Yeah. And there is a desire right now to hype out and hype up every single Linux vulnerability. So last week we talked about the kernel vulnerability for the RFC that allowed for the triple way handshake. Man-in-the-middle attack. And they fixed it in 4.7. That was a legitimate, honest-to-goodness bug in the Linux kernel that was honestly a problem. This is just simply malpractice. And you could mismanage any system. And I don't know what it is right now, but it must just get clicks. That must be what it is. But just, I want to just... Everybody, take it with a little grain of salt right now, and your Linux Action Show will try to break it down every single week if it's legit or if it's crap when we see it, because it's just awful. So let's shake that off with probably the best news that Noah has seen all frickin' week. You lucked out on this one, Noah. It could have gone proprietary lockdown, turned off on you, but it went the other direction. SimpleNote announces it is open sourcing its iOS, Android, and desktop apps.
Nice!
Yeah.
Is there a back-end component?
You know, I didn't really bother looking, but...
That's kind of the important part.
I think, let's see here, they have... the Electron app is open sourced. The other thing that's kind of interesting is these projects are some of the most popular on GitHub right now. Like, people are jumping at this. All right, so let's look at their GitHub page. You and I, you ready? We'll break it down here. Let's see if they have
it.
Let's
do it. I have code on GitHub, so I know I can understand this.
See, there's the DB stuff. Geez, wow. Yeah, no, I don't. Oh, it's by Automatic. Oh. Hmm. Yeah, I don't see it here. But yeah, that has got to be. SimpleNote. Speaking of follow up, if we really thought about it, we could follow up on a lot of our desktop app picks too.
Yeah, like pretty much every single week, we could there's something trying to follow up.
But SimpleNote. While we're in the news, though, we should just mention, as you're still using it as like your go-to note.
Yeah. Let's have this discussion. SimpleNote, the thing that Rakai and Chris badgered Noah to get on for weeks and weeks and weeks, and then Noah jumps on it, and then they take off and leave me in the dust. And I'm still on SimpleNote. You
it's
guys
called
are
a hustle, sweetheart.
So listen, Noah, I use it from time to time. I mean, I have a shared.
Yeah, here's how you use it. Here's how Chris uses SimpleNote. He goes, I need to share this doc and I really need Noah to pay attention to it. So I'll put it in SimpleNote and share it with them, because then you'll see it on his phone constantly.
That's true. But the other thing about it is there are some things SimpleNote's better for. But you know, I legitimately was having problems where
I know
notes
I
aren't
too.
Syncing between
problem.
Machines. Yeah. And yeah. I lost some notes content one time and I was done. Yeah. But now
if I'm willing to use a web browser anyway, I'd rather use a web browser and do things in SimpleNote than do things in Google Docs or.
Yeah,
or
yeah, sure. I mean, I'm feeling much better about it now that they're open sourcing it.
Yeah,
that's your words are irrelevant, because that's all that matters, because hopefully the community will work on it better. Yeah, Rikai says he uses SimpleNote all the time. So your face, sir. Your face. We're both still using SimpleNote.
I'm just saying, you guys were much more heavy on it when we started than you got me on board. And now I don't see many SimpleNotes getting shared as much
as I do
Google Docs.
That's true. It's legit. The usage has decreased, but maybe it will increase now that they have this new open source release. If you didn't hear us talk about a news item this week, well, you could submit it to linuxactionshow.reddit.com, but also we happened to pre-record this a week ahead of time for some scheduling issues. So that might be why if there was a huge news story that broke this week and you didn't hear us talk about it, I will try to make sure it fits into Linux Unplugged, so that way you can still get coverage on it. And if it's worth it, we'll definitely put it in next week's episode. But you can keep submitting them at linuxactionshow.reddit.com, because we might have just not seen it. Not very likely. But try submitting them there. Your votes and your comments also really do matter. Your vote matters there. Maybe there's not many other places that do, but the Linux Action Show subreddit, it actually does matter. All right, that's all the news for this week. Now comes that time that we make good on all those moments that we said we'll follow up in a future episode. At least we're going to give it our best and tell you how things are shaking up for many of the things we've talked about. First, I want to tell you about Linux Academy, sponsor of this segment, making it possible. Go to linuxacademy.com/unplug to support this show and learn more about the Linux Academy. All of the things around Linux, the technology stack itself, deep down, itty bitties, nitty gritties, and big picture stuff, they have it all. AWS, Azure, OpenStack, the entire DevOps category. If you want to learn some development things like PHP, Python, Ruby, frickin' Android, they got all of it. You guys, this is a really great system to learn more about many of the things we've talked about over the years. And they have a staff full of folks keeping the content fresh, keeping things relevant, and always investigating future content possibilities. They also have instructor mentoring available when you need it, and a community stacked full of Jupyter Broadcasting members. The lab servers spin up on demand when you need them. You can SSH right in. And the other thing that's super slick about that is you get to choose your distribution, and they'll automatically adjust the courseware and the virtual servers. They have practice exams and quizzes to help really get your head around something. The labs and exercises give you hands-on scenario-based training, and the learning plans work with your availability and scheduling. It's a pretty nice system. We got a message in from Dennis recently. He says, you make my commute enjoyable. Hey, guys, I just want to thank you for the great content you create. I listen each day on my 45-minute commute to and from work. And by the time I get to where I am, where I'm going, it feels like I just got done hanging out with you all. And I love it. I've learned a lot. And thanks to you, along with Ting DigitalOcean System 76, he is absolutely a happy Linux Academy customer. He says, I know you are all work really hard, and I really appreciate all that you do. Keep up the great work. So I think he went over to linuxacademy.com/unplugged to support the show. And look at this, dude. He's got the official Linux Essential completion cert, boom, right there from the Linux Professional Institute for LPI Essentials. Congratulations, awesome. Dennis. That is awesome, sir. Thank you for sending that in to us. And you can get started, too, at linuxacademy.com/unplugged. That's where you got to go to register your vote of support for the Linux Action Show. linuxacademy.com/unplugged. And a big thank you to Linux Academy for sponsoring the Linux Action Show, making it possible for us to sit here and tell you about this stuff. So I got a list, and I figured we could watch the chat room. Between the both of us, we could probably pull a few things out of the chat room. I want to start with Mint 18, just because it's kind of a quick one. I have Mint 18 still installed on the XPS 13, and I've only used it probably a handful of times since our Mint 18 review, and I just remind you, it's the Cinnamon Edition. Couple of things. Pretty much in all instances, when I just want like my go-to standalone, don't have to worry, haven't ran it for weeks and weeks and weeks machine, it actually works really well for that. I didn't notice during the review because I was hooked up to external display and I was doing video mirroring and I wasn't really paying attention to audio setup because I was trying to send audio out that. I didn't notice that my built-in sound card on the XPS 13 is not detected by Mint. I don't recall that issue in other instances. I don't know if I've ever tried 1604 on there. But
yeah, I did. I ran it with 1604.
Did you have any issues with the sound card?
None at all.
And I've also tried Arch on there many times with no issues on with the sound card. So that's just sort of an aside that I forgot to mention during my review because I didn't really notice it until I think like 4 days after our review, and that just didn't really seem relevant in the next episode. I'm probably going to replace that install with Elementary OS really soon because they just hit, I think they're near RC1, and I want to try out their high DPI implementation. But if I change my expectations from my daily driver and I change them to a machine that I just get around to every now and then, it's not super important to me. Mint works pretty good for that scenario for me for some reason.
Let me ask you this, and you probably know exactly where I'm going with this. How about a computer that is mission critically important, but you only touch it once every couple of weeks?
Yeah, that's kind of what I think it would be good for. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And maybe we'll see. I think Ubuntu Mate 1604 and Elementary OS might also play that role just fine, or just straight up Ubuntu 1604. Mm-hmm. Or
if you don't want
life. I mean, something that has long-term support would be good.
Yeah.
So let's talk about one thing that made an entire... We based an episode around, and that was episode 425. And that was remotely helpful. And that's where you talked about a new remote support, remote control, remote desktop solution that you'd come up, you know, and you were using. Mm-hmm. And that was Sandro on Twitter asked if you would do a little follow-up on how that's been going.
Sure. So we've now been using it for 6 months, I think, total. About a month or so, 2 months since we've done the episode, right? And basically what I did was we're actually really great. I ran the trial, ran it into the ground, and then needed some more time before I really wanted to make my decision.
Simple Help, is that what it's called?
Yeah, that's the name of the software. Yeah.
Okay.
Just emailed him, said, hey, here's the thing. I'm interested, potentially interested in buying it. Not really ready to do that yet. I need a little bit more time. And they just gave me another trial. So they extended my license out for another month or something like that. And we were able to run it. And that's where we went. And so the first step was we tested it and just doing like having people call in. And it was at that time that we did the review. Then shortly after we did the review and we decided we were really going to go forward with it, I had him extend the trial out. And we went and installed the unattended client on like 50 machines, 100 machines. And so then we got to see how the dashboard worked, which is I log in and I can click on any computer. And without the user having to do anything, I take control over their computer and I was able to do that. And after using that for a couple of weeks and seeing that that worked flawlessly and well, we signed an agreement and got on board with licensing.
Sticking with it.
Oh, yeah. It's been great. Now, again, I want to make the same disclaimer I made during the episode, which is that it's not open source, and it is hosted by one central company. And the promises that I'm getting from this company are identical to the promises I got from the previous company that screwed me. So it's and the situation is exactly the same. So I am so dumb. I am making the same mistake twice. But I don't know of any other option that I can pay a fee, because TeamViewer wouldn't be any better, right? And it's more expensive, and they could still pull the rug out from under me. So I still feel specifically
for remote end user support.
Right. So I still kind of have my eye to see if I can find something else. But so far, this is the best I've found.
And also I know folks continue to use X2Go and things like that, of course. But
if you don't mind forwarding ports.
Sure. I got a question that I thought was kind of perfectly timed. Broken Canoe tweeted me, given how much you use proprietary Dropbox, interested to hear your thoughts on privacy and security, fine line of balance, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, so we do use some Dropbox for some of our production stuff. A fair amount of our unfiltered clips and all of that are moved around in Dropbox. I initially had begun transitioning over to BT Sync or BitTorrent Sync, but when they made their changes, that became less attractive. So then I started deploying Sync Thing, but I haven't really had a Sync Thing deployment that's lasted more than a couple of months before it sort of stopped working for some other various reason. So recently, there is a brand new open source project. Yes, another freaking Sync project. It's called LibreVault. It's brand new from a gentleman out of Russia, I believe. And it aims to be the best of BitTorrent Sync and Sync Thing. It uses keys like BitTorrent Sync does, so I could just give you a key and you add it to your application, and now we're talking. You don't have to discover me, and we don't have to add each other to our crap. And so for me, huge. Because what I need to be able to do is I need to be able to drop a key out in the show notes and be like, if you would like all of the assets for this episode, you put this key in there. I can't sit there and add each individual audience member to my Sync Thing instance. And
right.
I would set up a introducer node or whatever the hell they're called if I could get a Sync Thing instance and set up to last me more than 2-3 months. So I was really keen on BitTorrent Sync because it allowed for me to use BitTorrent Sync as both the publishing platform and the RSS feed and the CDN. So you put a file in a directory, and everybody that has the key plugged into their BitTorrent Sync client all of a sudden gets a copy of the file, and then they begin to share it with everybody else. They don't have to be subscribed to anything. It just automatically shows up in a folder for them. And think about that. Think about if you had that connected to your Android TV box playing Kodi, and it just... a new episode of Last comes out, and it just shows up in the directory automatically where you have Last saved to. You touch nothing. The only person doing the work is me by putting a file in the directory once you add our key. And that's what BitTorrent Sync promised. It was going to be so nice. And, like, if we ever got a takedown notice or what's-their-faces over at Libsyn go out of business or whatever, we would have, like, this P2P backup system that I could just tweet out a key or whatever, Edward Snowden style, and get people to add it to their BitTorrent Sync client, and all of a sudden they could get our content. LibreVault promises to bring me all of that crap that I just ranted about and do it in a way that won't suck and won't eventually get closed source and behind a paywall. So I'm really excited about it. It's super alpha. There's only packages for Ubuntu. I have some African distro I've never heard of.
African word meaning I don't know how to use Debian.
Okay. And then also there's source code available, but it requires you build a few other things first, too. So LibreVault is now on my radar as I begin to look for a different solution to Dropbox. Another year has been added to the clock because we had to rebuy a Dropbox Pro, so I have time to do this. So they have time to work out some of the kinks.
So here's my problem is anything that is that is key-based is useless to me because...
Girl, are you crazy?
Well, hold on. Hear me out before you tell me I'm wrong. If I have to, so there are two possible ways. The first possible way is the key becomes like the private key that gives me access to the data. And if that's the case, how do I keep this key on me where I can get to it without it being insecure? I have to put it in something like KeyPass or whatever, and then I have to lock KeyPass. It's just a huge pain. And really, that key is super, super valuable because if anyone gets it, they can steal my data. They can steal stuff from my local hard drive. They can just pull it down to their computer. So that is the worst possible data breach possible. That key has to be protected with utmost security. And then, but the other problem is, If it's like the exchange mechanism where I had a key and you had a key, and so I can make sure that nobody can get to the data unless I have access to the machine to begin with, well, that's useless because then so I'm in Las Vegas and I've just blown away my laptop because I was worried about getting breached or whatever. And so I did my reinstall. Now, how do I get my stuff back? I don't have access to that key. If I had it on there to begin with.
This is a screencast that Wes put together to kind of show it because he was playing around with LibreVault. You see right here, you can generate a new key like in no time. Just you could okay. create a new key at any time that doesn't
but then
change
everything else that was thinking broke.
Yes. But that's also kind of a good thing in your scenario.
So now I got to go around to like 15 different machines and put this key back in. Like, I'm far more preferential to to a passphrase that I can memorize paired with an account name that nobody knows about or a username that nobody knows about.
Yeah,
and I install the client and just sign in like OwnCloud.
OwnCloud style. Right. And that might be my preferred setup for my personal file syncing. But for distribution of like ISO images or podcasts, like there was a couple of Linux distros I got over BitTorrent Sync. And what that meant, dude, is like when they published a new ISO, it just showed up on my machine one day. And I had a drive dedicated to that kind of stuff. And it was perfect. I agree, though. For personal syncing, something like OwnCloud, where you have a username and password-based login, and then it just pulls down your directories, might work better. So how has OwnCloud been going? Did you find we said we would give it a good go before we bailed on it. And I'm curious if you actually stuck to that.
I did. So I used OwnCloud, and I've gotten burned not once, not twice. Three times I have installed OwnCloud. Three times I put very important, irreplaceable data in OwnCloud. And three times I have lost data due to their idiotic file syncing. I don't know what they've changed, but in this last version, I started out and I went into it thinking I was going to lose data. In fact, I put files on there that I just expected to get corrupted.
I did that too.
I put some video files on there and I'm like, well, if those play in 6 months, well, that'll be a challenge. That'll be a feat. And sure enough, in a couple months later, those video files still played and big files were still syncing. And I'm like, well, this is kind of weird. So now I've begun putting back irreplaceable data because I'm a masochist back on OwnCloud. And I'll be darned, knock on wood, but we're a couple months in and I have not lost a single piece of data. Every file that's on there still opens. And I've been able to track as I'm taking rsync copies off of it so I can compare, make sure that I still have all the same files I started with, which didn't happen the first three times. But so far, it's been great. And the great thing about OwnCloud, and this time I have it set up with a Let's Encrypt certificate, and so it's HTTPS, and all you know that good stuff is set up and good to go, and the permissions are set on the HTTP/T directory, which is correct.
Nice.
But basically, I open my laptop up. The client, which is in my freaking repo, so it just installs.
That's also super nice. Yeah. Yeah.
I type in my username, I type in my password, I hit OK, and in a couple minutes, boom, all my files have sunk down to my laptop. And those are being hosted up on a DigitalOcean droplet. So I don't really have to worry about bandwidth or maintaining the server itself. And it's great. It's absolutely great.
My story.
And of course, day after I do this, or 2 days after I set this up, then, the whole Nextcloud.
And that's where my story takes over. So just a little bit after we got this set up, the whole OwnCloud Nextcloud split happened. And I decided to sort of pause and wait to see where this shakes out. Because we got a good, clear picture of the Nextcloud story. What we don't have a good, clear picture of is the OwnCloud story. And there's been some reporting on that now. But I kind of want to see where they go with the product, too. I want to see where both projects go with this. And so for me, it was worth hitting the pause button and just letting them both release a couple of times. And to be honest, that means I'm probably only halfway through this. Where let them release a couple of times and see which one looks like the better way for me to go. And so that's kind of where I'm at. I'm leaning Nextcloud right now. But I'm not counting OwnCloud out either. So yeah, for me, it's...
The thing is, until OwnCloud bites me, and from what I understand is they've put a ton of effort into Nextcloud, into making sure that people that have existing OwnCloud instances can basically upgrade to Nextcloud, right? So I'm not really worried about running into a project that's EOL. I have a feeling that when I get to the end, I'll just be able to, if we reach an end, if that ever happens, I'll just seamlessly move over to Nextcloud.
The harder that might be, though.
Maybe. But here's the thing. Because I'm not using OwnCloud for literally anything other than file syncing, let's face it, what am I really up against? If I had to start over from scratch, I take a copy of my OwnCloud folder because never, ever... Okay, if there's anything I've learned about OwnCloud, never under any circumstances start with data in the folder. You're asking for trouble. But I take a copy of my OwnCloud folder. I copy it somewhere else for a second. I set up my new Nextcloud server, and I copy the folder back in. Done. I mean, all right. We're talking 10 minutes?
Yeah, that's not so bad. I mean, yeah. I wonder if you used OwnCloud for more of the web-based features, if you would enjoy that too. Because you start using that, and you go, maybe I don't need this web app, and I don't need that web app. It's like it starts taking away some of those proprietary commercial hosted platforms, and I don't know. You see where it goes.
For me, it's all about the file sync at the moment.
But you want to know something funny? You're going to love this. You know what I've been using mostly in place of, because I don't use it for file sync as much. I used more of it for the web components, and what I was really using it for was sharing notes and contact and travel places with Hedea. And so we just created a Telegram thread and muted it, and we just used Telegram with hashtags to store that stuff. I pulled a Noah. I'm using Telegram.
I bet you're really happy how well it works and it never loses data.
Well, it hasn't lost data yet, but I am ready for a better system because I forget the hashtags. That's kind of embarrassing.
Yeah, that could be a problem.
That's kind of embarrassing. Yeah. I wanted to talk about something that we talked about within a week or two, and that's my Hughes lights. I remember I was complaining about that firmware update that I had to proceed with before I could control the Hughes lights. Well, two things. First of all, as far as the Hughes lights go, listener Ponick, I think is how you say it, or Poinick, he said, in related to the problems you have with your firmware update, I've developed an interactive bash script to control Hue lights. Look at that. You can even use it to block, even if you don't have any internet access at all, you can use this to manage your Hue lights. It's available for Arch Linux thanks to FS MaxB in the AUR, too. That's amazing that it's in the AUR. So that's cool, a bash script to control the Hue lights. But get ready for this. I think this might be the better way to go. I don't think there's any internet connection required here either. Now, mind you, this is a studio setting, and I only really use like 3 or 4 presets colors-wise, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe more, but not really. And if I had to, then I could use a different app. This just might be the way to go and mount it on the wall. Apparently, Philips just makes, get ready for this, light switches.
Yeah, I've seen those. That's how they demo them at Best Buy, actually.
Yeah, light switches.
They've got one of those things, yeah.
Yeah, so you can control the lights with light switches. And that you can assign a pre-programmed lighting scene to that. Mm-hmm. But you know what's crazy about these things? And what actually has me kind of interested in them?
Mm-hmm.
No batteries.
You might as well just bought them.
No, no batteries. Well, no batteries. They use kinetic energy.
What?
Yeah, dude. Yeah. So you don't have to keep...
Well, hold on.
That's what it says.
Time out. We're breezing over that like, oh, they just use kinetic... And then I'm just going to accept that and move on. Okay. So you take the light switch off the wall and rattle it
and
for
shake
a little
it,
bit?
And hey. Shake it? I don't know, man. I haven't bought one.
I'm just saying. It doesn't make any sense. Like
maybe it's just the force of pressing the buttons is enough to charge it. I doubt it, though.
But I'm...
Shake. Now I can turn on my light. Shake.
I said this the week that you announced. I'm going to say it again. I still think you need to look at DMX.
All right. So here's the other thing. Can you guess what this is?
No.
This is a LIFX. LIFX. This is given to me by listener Seth. It's got a 1,055 lumens. Okay. It has...
it's a bulb?
Yeah, it's a 75-watt LED bulb. Okay. And I'm gonna open it right now. See, I need something to cut this with. So this is kind of cool because it's also a Wi-Fi. What's the matter?
You're killing me with the Internet of Things, man. You're killing me. It's too much.
What are you? You an old curmudgeon? You can't hate everything.
Yes, I'm an old curmudgeon. Yes.
You can't hate everything.
That thing got an RS-232 port on it. Turn it on and off.
It's a light bulb that you can control.
Modern junk, I say.
You tease, but you know in a studio this is actually useful. And you use connected lights too. You just use a different type of connection. All right.
I do.
Sorry, Seth. I'm just ripping it open for time purposes.
It's literally RS-232.
All right. So look.
Not even kidding.
So this is much cheaper, he says, although I don't know what the price was. And it's LIFX, LIFX. This looks like a regular old light bulb, Noah. And it's much cheaper than the Hughes.
All right, fine, internet
connection required.
Here's my best argument for this, okay? I'm going to lay it out for you. Here it is. The modular standard system is the best possible system because it opens you to the widest range of flexibility. So every one of these brands that have their own protocol and their own system and their own software, even if it's highly accessible, is never going to be, in my opinion, as good as like a standard modular system that like hundreds of thousands of manufacturer devices conforming to a specific standard, and that standard is available on like a bazillion different kind of you know, different applications, including ones which run on GNU/Linux.
You old man. That's exactly where we're at now. That's exactly here. I'm going to get the box. I'll get this box here. All right. See, look.
Okay. Tell me the standard. Let's see if we've heard about it.
It works with the Nest systems. It works with like three or four different home control systems. Right, now look. Right. You're putting me in the position of defending this thing that I've never even tried before. But what I will tell you is, I think you ought to consider the fact that there are about three standards that are emerging that just about every one of these little dorky things supports.
Okay.
And that's
what
really
are those standards?
That's really all. I don't give a crap. I don't know what the standards are.
But that's the problem. If there is a standard, if first of all, three standards does not qualify as a standard, then we have three standards, right? But we need a standard. And once we have a standard, then we need adoption on that standard so that people are writing applications for Linux that support that standard.
Never
and stuff like that.
Look,
and here's the other thing, too. And here's the other thing. That's my point. And here's the other thing, too. And it is almost a bigger point is do those protocols and do those standards, do they require some sort of company or third party or internet connection or whatever to exist for that standard to continue?
Yes.
That's no useless to me. I don't like
it. Here's the thing, as you like to say, Noah, that whole little triad there you just had.
Yeah.
The only way that would ever happen
uh-huh.
is if you took away Amazon, you took away Apple, you took away Microsoft, you took away Google, you took away Walmart, you took away Philips, you took away every company that has that has stake in this game, you took away all the hardware makers, and then you create a public government office that creates one software stack and one hardware platform and then distributes that to the people. That's the only way you could accomplish what you're saying.
Explain DMX to me then.
You are never going to have. That is a totally, first of all, a different era and a totally different thing. Because what we have now is it is the world of apps, phones, and Wi-Fi. Right.
I don't like any of that stuff. I'm out of relevant.
That's an entirely separate episode that you and I should have. We should have at some point because I think I think we could both talk about that. But what I'm trying to say is it doesn't matter what you want. It matters where we are. This is the reality of it is world we live in now.
Okay, I'll tell you, here's the reality I live in. The reality I live in is that there are two worlds, and one world is the consumer, appy, marketability, Wi-Fi connected, internet of thingy, just plug it in and it works. That's one market. And then there's the other market of the professional standard where you have a whole list of manufacturers that are making very, 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 very refined devices that conform to a specific standard. And yes, it isn't just plug it in and it works. It requires a little bit of configuration. You actually have to have a brain between your two ears. But if you do that, it opens you up to a tremendous amount of flexibility. And you can do things like maybe we'll show this at Christmas time. I automate my house lights and I've got these little trees that stand out and they all dance to the music. You can't do that with your Hughes lights. You can't do that with your light thingamabob that you have in your hand there because it's not going to tie into the controlling software that has all the timing stuff. That's only possible because that software and the lights that go with it and the dimmer pack that goes with it all conforms to a single standard.
Are you good? Are you good? See, you're coming at me like
I just
like
another thing.
Like you're coming at me like one thing is supposed to do all of the things. Yeah, okay. So if you have this crazy ass, nearly madman Christmas lighting setup that has to hit light cues.
Yeah.
That seems like a different use case than the Hughes lights.
No. See, This is the crux of my argument.
No,
It does everything from last night. I had a wedding and I just wanted to turn the walls purple. That's it. I wanted the walls to be purple. And I took four or five of these cans and I pointed them at the wall and I put in the RGB of the wedding color and boom, the wall was purple. That was it. It just turned the wall purple.
Here's why you're crazy.
The same system, the same protocol, the same everything goes all the way from just, oop, I want the wall to be purple, all the way to flashy Christmas lights, everything changes.
Here's the difference.
Okay.
That light bulb
and
these Hughes lights.
Yes.
All you have to know how to do is screw in a light bulb and launch an app.
Exactly. Exactly.
That's why it's at a totally different scale because it's much more approachable by millions of more people.
I agree. And I don't like that.
Okay. All right. Well, you could not it. That's fine.
No. But like,
I don't like Windows. So there we go.
Yeah, that is true. That's true. But there's just this idea that we should trade our, you as a Linux user. I feel like I shouldn't be explaining this to you. You as a Linux user, somebody who likes to dig in and understand all these stuff, does it not frustrate the ever-loving heck out of you when like your mother or your sister calls you up and they're like, hey, I don't understand. Like the power went out and like the internet went out and now I can't get to Netflix. Netflix isn't working and I don't understand why. And it's like, and then you're sitting there at the other end and you're like, do you not understand that Netflix is a service and runs on the other end of the internet? So if you don't have internet, it doesn't work. And this idea of the cloud, the very fact that we call it a cloud, that we don't call it a server-client relationship, is the antithesis of everything that makes a nerd, because you don't understand what is happening. We willfully accept that as geeks, we're just going to put our data, poof, where'd it go? In the cloud. I don't know. It's on some server. I don't know where it is. It's just in the cloud.
Noah, here's the problem. Just like the term the cloud and vlogging, and let's be honest, blogs, I never even liked the term blogs.
Yeah, actually.
These things have all happened regardless of how much we don't like them. And so...
Doesn't mean I'm buying into it. Doesn't mean that you should buy into it.
Here's where I draw the difference. That light bulb there, $30 or something like that, can be controlled by pretty much any device that can talk TCP. So these,
as long as the software exists and the protocol continues to be developed and somebody writes the app for it. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But again, that is a good step in the right direction compared to some of the other Internet of Things devices. So I think there's a middle ground.
That's
there.
The one part thing I think I agree with you on.
All right.
It's a step in the right direction compared to a lot of the other Internet of Things.
So yeah, I agree. We got to stop talking about, I can't believe we just talked this much about lights. Okay. I can't believe it. Chat room, I blame Noah. He gets passionate about lights.
There are a few things, not lights, Internet of Things. I hate internet connected devices. I hate them. I hate them with a passion.
Yeah. What I really like is like damn controllers connected to the internet. Okay, so I wanted to follow up on my Entraware Apollo. Episode 406 of this show, we said it was the MacBook killer. You guys are probably familiar with the Entraware. Hopefully you saw that episode of the show. It was, was this something to review. I had never really kind of experienced a Linux laptop like this. And so this remains my daily driver. This is the machine that I use just about... every evening, every morning, to prep for the day before I go into work and then follow up and wrap up on stuff in the evening. It is a great workhorse. I will say this, though. As time has gone on, and I don't know if it's like a... It might be more of a GNOME 3 thing, but the trackpad picks up on my typing sometimes when I feel like my thumbs are just hovering above the trackpad, and it sends my cursor off all over the place, and I often cock up whenever I'm writing. Just totally gets lost. It's really bad.
Do you have tap to click on?
Maybe.
Because that what you're describing is exactly what was happening to me when I have tap to click on.
Yeah, I might. What I normally do is I just typically, and I think I got just a GNOME extension to do this, go figure, is I typically just have the desktop environment disable the trackpad when I'm typing altogether.
Yeah, I feel like I've still had issues though, where tap to click like randomly selects and jumps all over the
place. It's jumpy, it's bad. So that's my only thing is that, and it seems to be super sensitive about even. So that's the only thing I've really noticed. Performance wise, I've thrown a lot of stuff at it and it's still been a great little machine. And I've edited video on this thing and I've really enjoyed it. So the Entraware really has a hit on their hands there with that one. Do you want to follow up any hardware? What about that? That laptop you recently got, the ThinkPad.
Yeah. So I've got a couple things. So the ThinkPad is I carry it in my bag. I have it here today. I just, since I've gotten the Surface, I haven't really pulled it out a whole lot. I've been trying to do more and more on the Surface simply because it's there. But the ThinkPad is one of those devices that it's not really exciting. It just does exactly what it was supposed to do from day one. And I've never really had an issue with it, except, of course, the wireless doesn't work on 1604. One thing I am going to change out, though, is I've now run out of hard drive space on it. So I took the cover off to try to see what it's going to take to upgrade the hard drive. And they only have, in the review, I said it was an M.2 drive. It is not an M.2 drive. The M.2 slot is actually taken up by the WAN card. There's only one M.2 slot, and it's taken up by the GSM WAN card. So the hard drive is actually a 2.5-inch SATA drive. Now, that said, I have gotten to the point where I've realized if I can mistake it as myself of the performance of an M.2 drive, there's probably no reason. I might as well just stick with the 850 Pro. So I'm just going to buy, I'm going to put another 850 Pro in there. I'm just going to put they just released a 2 terabyte version. And so I'm going to put a 2 terabyte 850 Pro in there. Yeah.
Nice. Rotten Corpse in the chat room, AKA Mr. Tanel, asks if our experiment with Rocket Chat and Mattermost continues. And it has, in fact, Eardrum set us up a, or Eardrum, not Eardrum.
Adrum.
I'm sorry, what? Set us up a Mattermost, I'm sorry, what? A Mattermost server that we've been playing around with, and I like it a lot. We're still using Slack more just because there's a lot of momentum there, and people already have Slack accounts. One of the things that's really tough for this type of application is some of the people we want to interact with are already in Slack for their day jobs. And so they're already in the application, and so at Jupiter Broadcasting, Slack is not an extra thing for them, really. I mean, it's an extra one to participate in, but it isn't an extra app they have to install, an extra domain they have to create, an extra account they have to set up. They just already have all that crap. So the adoption's been slow, and we haven't seen it. We haven't really figured out like a big use for it in the general audience either. We've experimented every now and then with a live show here or there, but I don't know. I haven't quite nailed it down yet, but we do have it deployed, and I do really like it. Okay, I wanted to follow up on the OBS live streaming thing.
Yeah.
A lot of people have asked about that. So do you want to talk about where we're at with cloud OBS? And also, we could just talk about some of our thoughts and ideas about upgrading your video and audio so that way we have better parity and quality.
Yeah, so for starters, we don't do cloud OBS. We run a server-client relationship. I'm just kidding.
That's good.
So we're gonna do a cloud OBS system. And basically, we have had like right after the segment aired, we had a bunch of people write in, and some people, like there's this guy on Twitter, actually set the entire system up and made a video of him using it and then sent me a link and said, here, I'll give you access to this so you can use it. And I haven't had a chance to follow up with him, but like he did that in our own West from Linux Unplugged, figured out another way to remote control the thing, and he got that set up and did a couple screenshots, and that's working. And then Chris and I actually, I think it was last week.
2 weeks ago, but yeah.
We're so ready to actually try this that we came into the studio and early. We set everything up about how we were going to do an episode, and it was beautiful. Everything was just great. And we ran into a couple tiny little things that we know how to fix. It's just a matter of finding the time to actually fix them. Sounds like we might need another machine in the mix. But once we have that working, I will look exactly like I do that week that I was hosting, where I'm crystal clear and I look good. And then Chris will look just as good as he does. And it'll all come together in magical harmony. And then that will get edited. Mm-hmm. And anything that doesn't work, Rikai can just fix and post.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
But the idea is that we're going to have local video on each side sent to a central location. And then that will ultimately make the main mix. It will also enable Chris to move JB1 up into the cloud. We don't know where it's going. It's just poof into the cloud.
Other people's
and
servers,
then it
dude.
Will be up. On DigitalOcean and into the cloud, and we'll have no idea how it works. It'll just work with apps and stuff. And then he'll be able to go anywhere in the country and connect with Lady Jupes and be able to connect in and do shows from the road. So you won't necessarily have to have he won't have to have somebody filling in for him. He can just do it from whenever he wants. And we're not relying on Comcast anymore, which seems to be a continual
part of the ultimate plan.
Marcus.
Yeah, plus, if we could do this in a way that genuinely gave us like a higher production quality, I think if it was reproducible and available on Linux, I think other podcasts would probably start producing their video that way too. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a lot of reasons to pull it off. Okay, I had one other kind of follow up question. I'm watching the chat room too. There's a few I've pulled in from the chat room.
Mm-hmm.
But there was one last one that I wanted to save. Maybe why don't we answer this now and I'll watch the chat room, see if any of the last minute questions come in. But I got asked this morning, what's a mumble room? What is that? You guys just throw, you say
Are you
mumble
serious?
Room. Yeah. 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 What? What? What are you saying?
They legitimately don't, like, mumble is the greatest thing since sliced bread. I live in mumble. How do you not know what mumble is?
People, and like, I think last week you said somebody in the mumble room, I got my Surface Pro from somebody in the mumble room. Yeah. And it's like, what's a mumble room?
Yeah, okay. So for those of you that apparently have been living under a rock, Mumble is a VoIP client that is available on Mac, Windows, and Linux. The server, Murmur, is a component of Mumble and can be run by yourself. And so we have a couple of people in the community that are actually hosting that for us up on DigitalOcean.
There's also a one-click deployment for DigitalOcean if you want to host your own.
Yeah. And so on Tuesdays every week, the Jupiter Broadcasting has a show where they have an open Mumble room. Anyone can join, and you open your Mumble client and connect to the Mumble server, and then you can push your control key to talk to other people. Everyone else can hear you. They can talk. You can hear them. And we make a show out of it. Well, you guys, you and Wes, make a show out of it. And every once in a while, I'm there. Yeah.
Tech Talk today is also, we have an open Mumble room, and basically we have rooms you go into. People check your microphone in one room, and if your mic's okay and you don't have echo and feedback and you're good enough connection, you get moved down to the next room, and then you get to comment on the stories we're talking about as part of a lug. It's like our virtual Linux users group, and that's what we use it for.
So and that's the official side of it. Now, Unofficially, the room is hopping pretty much every night. I get home around 6-7 o'clock, and first thing I do, I go downstairs, I get myself something to eat, and I have my keys. I use Mumble so much, I have hotkeys on my keyboard. So I'm in Mumble, and I walk downstairs, and I hit a specific F key, and it drops me into what we call the lobby, and we sit there and talk. And I've become really good friends with everyone that's in the Mumble room. And in fact, DEF CON, the entire group I went with, it actually started like at 3 a.m. One of the guys was like, we should go to DEF CON. Who wants to go to DEF CON? And a bunch of us were like, yeah, well, I'll go to DEF CON. So we just decided everyone in the Mumble room is going to go to DEF CON. And so the big Mumble group, we all met up in Minneapolis and drove around, hung out in the Mall of America and did things all day, and then got on a plane and we all flew to Las Vegas and then spent 4 or 5 days hanging out. And in fact, like this is kind of funny. We talked to each other so much on Mumble that we're used to hearing each other and not seeing each other.
Yeah.
I was looking around and it was funny. We're all sitting in the terminal, right? Waiting for the last two people to get off the plane. And we're sitting there and we're talking, but nobody will look at each other. We're all just looking straight ahead and like listening to each other talk. And it's just kind of weird to see people, but you build really quality relationships and some of the smartest people I've ever met. It's super fun.
So you can find out about our Mumble server. Go into our IRC chat room, go to jblive.tv and then bang Mumble. And it'll PM you back. You have to be able to receive anybody. You have to be registered to receive PMs, probably. You'll receive. So there's a couple of hoops we have you jump through, just so that way it's not crazy overloaded. You get the Mumble server back address back. You connect. The client is open source, and it's essentially voice chat IRC. IRC for voice with rooms and stuff.
And we do, and we have expanded it now too. We use so Mumble. We do the voice component. We also use OpenTalk, and so we get the webcams going so that we can kind of see and chat and show each other different things. And so usually we'll have two windows. We'll have Mumble going in one window, and then OpenTalk going in another window, so that you can participate in like a video chat thing. It's
OpenTalk WebRTC.
Yeah,
that's interesting. Let's talk more about that. because I also know, I don't know about like 6 podcasts right now, I think, that are being recorded over Mumble. They use Mumble for the back and forth, and then they record locally, and it works really well for that. It's just a lot, and Mumble also has built-in recording facilities that make it easy to do that. So Mumble is a super nice open source tool, you can set
here's
up
how you know. Here's
like
how you know Mumble. Here's how you know Mumble is doing it right, because there are people that are hardcore TeamSpeak guys that won't touch TeamSpeak anymore. They've switched to Mumble because they think it has a number of advantages. When you see proprietary people that have no allegiance to the open source software saying that the open source version is better, that's how you know it has, even if there are benefits and detractors to both, that's how you know it has some serious teeth.
Yeah. Yeah. So there you go. Do you have any other items from the previous episodes you want to follow up on, any past topics or? Oh, the Android TV box. How's your Android TV box working out?
Yeah. Okay. So I got, after we did the episode, I took the box home and I put the latest version of Kodi on it. Latest version of updated everything the way I didn't want to do it, but did it anyway.
What do you mean? You use the Play Store? What do you mean?
Well, yeah, I didn't want to bring it online. Remember, I wanted to take it out of the box.
Yeah, so you ended up, okay. All right.
Put it online, sideloaded the Play Store, opened up, updated the app, got the latest version of Kodi.
Good.
All that stuff. Well, here's the thing.
Does it play any better?
Yes. It plays better. Good. However, still takes forever to play over Wi-Fi. It works. I would recommend it 100% as a wired box. Works great for that. But over wireless, it is just, unless it's literally within 15 feet of an access point, it's just super, super.
I'm worried about that because I'll be using wireless too.
Well, but I remember I'm opening ISO files too. So I'm, if I'm playing a movie, I'm moving an 8 gig file you know, across the network. So,
yeah, but, whereas, but, like, an MP4 file, a lot of them you can actually start loading them and playing them before the whole file is loaded. And,
exactly. Yeah. And you're only moving the, you know, so if you've got a 4 gig DVD rip, probably 800 megabytes of that is the actual movie, right? And the rest of it is, but as a wire box, I'm using it downstairs in my little shop area, and it works great for that. I don't, at this point, I can't replace all my Western Digital TVs with them because the Western Digital TVs are doing so much better. They work flawlessly over wireless. But what I'm hoping is within a year or two, these get better and better, and maybe the updates get a little bit better, and eventually it will just start working because it has an end card in it. So I would imagine, you know, it's the bandwidth is there. It's just a matter of getting the software up to encoding that stuff. So, in fact, those Western Digital boxes I think are G, and they work fine.
That's interesting. Yeah. It might just literally be how the software reads ISO images.
That's kind of what I'm thinking.
So my NVIDIA Shield TV working great, and I resolved the Kodi naming issues by using Tiny Media Manager. It is what a tool, you guys. What a tool. Oh my gosh. You point at a directory full of crazy ass episode names and stuff like that, and you right click, man, it goes out, it scrapes the web for all that information, gets all the photos, gets all of the episode metadata, it renames all the files, it adds the NFO and all the info that Kodi needs. And here's what's awesome. I did it all here at the studio, using the studio's bandwidth to pull down all those images and all that stuff and load them on the external drive. And then I took it home, where I have the MiFi connection, hooked up the USB drive to the NVIDIA Shield TV, opened up Kodi, everything was there. Nothing had to be loaded off the net. Every like episode still, everything, all of my adventures of Superman recognized, detected, everything sorted out, all of my metadata sorted. Tiny Media Manager, it's a Java app, but man, does it kick ass. So, really, really happy about that because now we're using Kodi for everything. I haven't launched Plex for like 2 weeks.
Wow.
It's nice. And I got...
It's interesting. You know, we have widely different use cases and widely different preferences, and yet we've both really landed on Android and Kodi. That's kind of where I'm at, too. I don't think I could find anything else that, that at least is being made today that is any better than Android with Kodi on it.
Yeah. And now I wanted to say one more thing for you, because I know you have ISO images because you don't want to... You have the storage space. Why lose any quality at all, right? Just...
Basically, here's what I'm going for. Here's what I want. I never want to ask the question, I wish I had the DVD because. I never want to say
when
that.
When does that happen?
Well,
it must happen sometimes, right?
I'll tell you, I can tell you the first time it happened because that's when I made the decision. First time it happened was I was watching Avatar and I had the actual rip of the movie. And later I was talking to one of my buddies and he's like, did you see the special features in there? They have this deal where it goes through and they explain how they did all this stuff. And I'm like, no, I don't, because all I did was rip the movie. I didn't ever think about this. But, so now, and I'll tell you what, lately I got back from Japan. You know, one of the first things I did, I went back through my movies and found which ones have Japan tracks on it, and now I'm listening to it in Japanese to kind of brush up. And the thing is, when I ripped the movie, I would have bet you dollars to donuts, I would have never said, oh, I want other languages. I would have said, I speak English and sarcasm. I don't need French and German and Spanish. And-
no, I follow. so I'm of two minds of this. So here's where I was going to go with this. Because you have the ISOs, you can always go back to the ISO. I'm not about to propose you should get rid of the ISO, but what I'm about to suggest to you, I'm going to go a little Alan Jude on you.
Okay.
If possible, what you should do is leverage the hell out of ZFS's data compression and just get all your ISOs out of your media setup and throw them somewhere tucked away on your NAS for really safe storage and just compress the hell out of them using ZFS.
Okay.
Then, on your front-end media playbacks, what I would do is I would use Auto MKV or Make MKV. I think it's Make MKV.
Make MKV, yeah.
And just extract the video, and you could do as many of the audio tracks or things you want. And you don't re-encode, just re-encapsulate them in an MKV.
Yep.
And throw those on for Kodi to play back, because they'll play instantly. And if you did want to go back and get the Japanese version, you can always go back to the ISO, because that's probably you only probably need to go back to the ISO a few times a year.
You know, not only that, you might be onto something. And so two things occur to me. If I did this in I can buy 4 terabyte drives pretty cheap now. If I bought a 4 terabyte
hard drive. 6 terabytes. It's
six, whatever. Yeah. Whatever the cheapest one is. Whatever the cheapest denomination is. Yeah, six. Okay. And I dump those ISOs onto it and put them in a cold shelf.
Yeah.
Now I've got, not only do I have the original ISOs, but that could serve as a cold shelf backup for all of the movies.
Right.
One of the things
you probably use less space on your active live storage. Because you'd have just the video track and not all the different tracks.
Jeez, man, I'd have to go through and do that for like 1,400
Although,
videos.
If the directory structure is sane, there is a command line. There's a command line version, I think, of Make MKV that you could.
Oh, is there?
Maybe.
The directory structure is just there's a folder called movies and they're all in there.
But then that would solve your playback issue. Plus, it sort of opens you up to a lot more devices you could play. But anyways, something to think about because then you wouldn't have to be loading ISO images. And there's way more things to playback.mkv.
Boy,
right now
you're telling me.
Yeah.
It's not just one time I've run into that roadblock. It really isn't.
All right, so I'm scanning the chat room to see if there's anything else they want to cover, but I think, I see you could throw it through Handbrake, but then he's compressing it, and I think one of the things he's trying to avoid is.
Especially, and here, tell you what, you don't understand Handbrake compression when you're watching it on a 20 or 30-inch TV. I have a 150-inch screen that's in my basement with a projector on it. Believe me, when you blow it up that big and you're sitting 15 feet away from it, you can tell when it's been run through Handbrake. You can easily tell when it's been through Handbrake. People that have no audiovisual, experience and don't have an eye for it walk in and they're like, I'm serious. It looks terrible. I mean, there's a huge difference.
Yeah, if you can see it, then that's what matters. If you can't see it, then you're lucky and it doesn't matter. But if you do notice it, you can't unnotice it. And I know what you mean. So I feel like there's probably 1,000 things we could probably keep following up on, but this episode would go on forever. So we could bank some more.
One last thing to follow up on. Yeah. I am still using the Microsoft Surface. It's working. No, it is still working great. A week later, I am still really loving it.
It's good, man. It's good.
Get that out there.
I'm really glad. Why don't you install Ardour 5 on that and tell me how that runs, and then maybe I'll be more tempted. All right. So that's sort of following up on topics that we've promised to tell you more about that I recall off the top of my head. If we've missed something, let us know. We can start banking new ones. Send them in to linuxactionshow@jupiterbroadcasting.com or use the contact form, and we'll try to start keeping a list. Maybe in simple note, Noah? And then we'll have a future episode. We'll follow up on some of that stuff. Oh, God. All right. That's all the follow-up for this week. And that brings us to the end of this week's broadcast. But before we get out of here, Noah, we got a special feedback to get to. So I want to take a moment and thank System76 over System76 for sponsoring this segment. They make machines designed, built, perfectly tuned to run Linux. Go over to system76.com and tell them the Linux Action Show sent you. In fact, tell them Noah switched you to Linux. Maybe you'll get something a little extra special. You hear us talk about Surface Books and crap like that. That stuff's all junk. Get it out of here and go get yourself a System76. Realistically, if you want something that's going to work really well, easy to reload, has a long future ahead of it, and backed by a company that's been around for more than 10 years as a Linux vendor, system76.com. Go check them out. Desktops, laptops, the whole shebang. System76.com. Okay, Noah, so we have a special video feedback, and I'll leave it to the audience to see if they can guess within the first couple of seconds who it is. Linux Unplugged listeners might have a bit of an edge. Spoiler alert, he's going to tell you who he is. But it's a special video message. Uh-oh. Can you tell who it is? Do you have any guesses? Do you have any guesses who this is? Could you have any idea who this man is?
It's not Linus Torvalds, right?
It is not Linus. It is producer Michael Tunnell.
Show producer, also known as Rotten.
Tunnell. Tunnell. There. All right, I'll let him say it. He says it right. Are you ready, Noah? Brace yourself. Here we go. Tunnell. Or the artist formerly known as Rotten Corpse. Take it away, producer Rotten Corpse, formerly known as Rotten Corpse, a.k.a. Michael Tunnell. Right, Noah?
Good old Mitchell Tunnell.
Yeah? Mitch Tunnell, here we go.
Hi, I'm Michael Tunnell, Linux Action Show producer, also known as Rotten, and I had a question for the last community. Do you use a screensaver? And if so, do you use any kind of disabler tool, like Caffeine, to disable that screensaver? And if so, why? Recently someone asked me a question about alternatives to Caffeine, and my first response was, Caffeine's a tool to disable your screensaver, so why not just disable your screensaver completely? I mean, I haven't used a screensaver in about 5 years, probably more, just at least 5 years. In fact, this is not even a screensaver right now.
What?
This is a video of a screensaver playing in a loop. So I'm just curious, if anyone twist. In the community uses a screensaver and a disabler tool, and if so, why? Thanks.
I use caffeine. I do. I have caffeine installed.
But his first question was, why do you use a screensaver?
Well, I think I don't actually use screensavers, but I could see myself
using.
I could see myself.
So, but then what's the purpose of caffeine if it's not disabling a screensaver?
Power saver for me.
Oh.
Yeah, it also prevents the screen from going to sleep, which sometimes breaks like HDMI capture and whatnot. I actually kind of think though, if you're gonna leave your machine running for a little bit before the screen goes to sleep, you got the spare cycles. Sometimes screensavers are retro cool. Like this is probably more information than I should give away. This is gonna be kind of embarrassing.
Does it involve a red shirt and cumulus?
Nope. I actually, and you can fork it on GitHub if you want it yourself. I actually found After Dark in CSS. Are you familiar with After Dark?
No.
Yeah, I didn't think so. So After Dark was a screensaver, I think it was available on Windows, but it was available on Macs too. Before Mac OS X, back when they had like the old System 7 and System 8, I had this thing called After Dark. And it had cool things like flying frickin' toasters. You ever seen the flying toasters? You ever seen this? This is one of the best screensavers of all time, and now I have it in my web browser. Huh? I got flying... flying toasters in my web browser.
Check this out.
You bastard. You bastard.
I'm happy for you. You and your internet light bulbs and your flying toasters.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Here's a bouncing ball. Also a classic screensaver. Who doesn't like a bouncing ball?
I remember this. This wasn't a Mac OS thing, was it?
After Dark might have been available for other platforms too, but that screensaver is not.
I remember that screensaver being in Linux, and then I remember there was the coolest one. It took that ball, and there was a guy that like juggled him, and it was super, super cool. I used to wait till my computer went to sleep and then watch it for like hours.
What are you guys talking? Juggling balls is something totally different. What are you talking about?
Never mind. It's the same ball. They had the ball, then the guy juggled it, and then it went into multiple balls, and then he juggled multiple.
Guys with balls. I'm talking about screensavers, Noah.
Me too. It was a screensaver.
Wow. I think this app, so if you want to get your retro screensaver on, I'll link this in the show notes because this is pretty cool. It's After Dark in the web browser. So for me, the screensavers remind me of like Star Trek sets and stuff. Like when I see like the computer like twirling stuff around, I'm like, that looks like space.
LCDs do have burn-in. So for anyone that doesn't think that they do, I can take pictures of you of LCDs that have burn-in from having been on.
Especially when they like show big Jupiter Broadcasting logos for many hours of the day.
Really? That happened?
On this one right here that you're talking to me on, yeah. Starting to happen.
Well, yeah, it does happen. The screen and I can take pictures of it. So there is, I think the idea of like why we don't care about screensavers is because we think that LCDs don't suffer from burn-in, and it doesn't happen as fast as it did on CRTs, but it definitely, I think there is some use for it.
Why not just turn your screen off if that's
exactly? That was exactly what I was about to say. Personally, I'd rather just the computer go to sleep or the screen
save power.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because
I know, but then again, if I could have flying toasters on my screen, I might keep that.
You know what I want? I want flying Windows logos coming at me.
No, you don't. You remember that though? God, that was awful. Yeah. So then I have recently. Do you remember when I did my Plasma 5 stint for a while, and I was running the Plasma 5 desktop not too long ago?
Yeah, audio didn't work great. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, I had some issues with audio, but I got audio more squared away by using a process of elimination by disabling every audio device that I never wanted to use, and only leaving the audio device enabled that I would ever want to use. By a process of elimination, I solved my audio problems in KDE. But the other weird thing, and I could never figure out a way to solve it. Nobody could help me. The only solution was to uninstall my X screensaver. My KDE systems were starting my screensaver no matter what my settings were. There was something broken in that version of Plasma Desktop where you couldn't control the screensaver. And so no matter what I set, my screensaver would start after a few minutes. So here I am like a jerk sitting back watching Mr. Robot. Screensaver starts. Horrible. I didn't want to uninstall the package because every now and then, like once every 3 months, I like to run a screensaver and be like, hey, look at the screensaver.
You know, last night I reinstalled the light control machine, you know, that uses the standard lighting system.
You mean you have an entire machine dedicated to that?
So I had this lighting control machine, and I reinstalled. I went with Ubuntu Mate because, you know, I wanted wireless to work, and it does it in 1604. and so I noticed last night, we're like halfway through the show, and apparently the default screensaver is 30 minutes in. It kicks in at Ubuntu Mate, and little icons start floating around the screen. It's very adorable. Not so much when you're doing a show and like, yeah. I'm like, that computer is controlling things. because here's the thing. If it sends the on signal, it has to then send the off signal. If anything gets interrupted, the 1500 watt strobes just go crazy and it drives everyone.
Oh, wow. Bitten in the chat room says that he had to help mom and brother out with that on OpenSUSE with the screensaver just a couple of weeks ago. You know, it's just like it felt kind of weird. Like I go look at it, my screensaver's off, and my screensaver would turn on. But I remember the CRT days where you needed that, and so I still like having it from time to time. That's why I have it. I don't use them on any of my production computers, and none of it installed here. But maybe every now and then I put on a machine like up in my office or something like that. And I use caffeine here to make sure that the screens don't turn off while I'm doing a show. So during a show, caffeine clicked on, and then after a show, I click caffeine off, and the screens stay on for the whole show. Capture doesn't break. All right, if you'd like to send us a question, linuxactionshow@jupiterbroadcasting.com or jupiterbroadcasting.com/contact and choose Linux Action Show from the dropdown. You can tweet me. I'm @ChrisLAS or tweet Noah @KernelLinux. If you'd like to give me something directly like feedback or information or a link or anything you want to chat at me about, Twitter does tend to be the place that I have the highest success rate at replying. Pretty much reply and read every single tweet that gets sent at me on Twitter. All the other avenues... they've just been totally blasted out.
No. Here. This is the industry term. Ready? The other avenues are best effort only.
Yeah, that's good, dude. That's good. Yeah, emails. Right,
that's
especially.
What they say. They're best effort. Yeah. Which, in other words, the translation. I don't really care if I happen to get to it. I will.
Well, it's just you go in there and there's so much. It overwhelms me and I guess my mind shuts down. LinuxActionShow.reddit.com is where you go to submit content, news stories, open source projects you want us to talk about, things we should spotlight, or just some good feedback and your insights. All appreciated as well as your votes. LinuxActionShow.reddit.com. This show's live on Sundays over at jupiterbroadcasting.com/live or jblive.tv, and you can find it at the calendar page to find out when we are live. Noah, is there anything else we should cover on here, this here podcast that we do, known as 431?
I don't think so. Oh, actually, yes. I've been meaning to mention this for like 3 weeks. So AltaSpeed is trying to pick up our Twitter account @AltaSpeed. We're trying to tweet more and more informational things we pick up from JB. And also, as of this weekend, I don't know if they've actually gone out yet, but we have a ton of pictures and stuff from this last week's event. So if you'd like to see an entire wedding powered by Linux, the lights, the sound, the whole nine yards, using standard non-Internet of Things devices, check us out on Twitter @AltaSpeed.
Cool. All right, everybody. Thanks so much for tuning in this week's episode of the Linux Action Show, and we'll see you right back here next week. Black hole, sun, won't you come and get simulated by a Linux box? You ought to fly over here for a week and do a nighttime show. That's all you got to do. Just do a nighttime show with Noah.
Dude.
Do I have
to fly there to do that? Because
I guess not really. You should.
God, I would have so much fun. I would. That would be one of the funnest things I've ever done.
If
I could do a show at like 2 a.m, one, it would be in my wheelhouse. Two, I'd be like wide awake because that's my hour. Fuck, dude. Like, there's so many things that would just be great about
you. You should, because you know what? When I said it, I forget. You are your own. You are really your own unique snowflake in the sense that you really have the full setup necessary to broadcast on your own.
Doing it in the middle of that, God, that would be
you
fun.
Could even...
And, you know, the other thing is, too, is the barrier to entry is super low. If I screw it up, it's 2 a.m. Who cares?
If this is a porn hosting website, then that is the wrong...
It's not a porn... I don't...
That is the wrong picture.
Here's the thing. I'm highly offended that everyone keeps calling this a porn thing, because I'm going to use this. I'm going to use the hell out of this.
For porn, or...
No!
Well, then you could have given me a little more in the...
Porn to host.
How come you didn't give me any more in the thing? You didn't give me like, I seem like you're
like... Because you're like, this is a great... Here's your pitch. You're like, here's the spotlight. Now, I have no interest in this. It's totally useless. No,
and I'm like, that would have been your point to go, I could use that. I'll see it. Yeah. That would have been...
Oh, my goodness. I'm sorry. I tell you what. Here, I'll make it up to you, boss. I'll make it up to you. Here's what I'm going to do.
It's too warm.
I'm going to use it. And I'm going to film a show segment about using it, and then you'll get a whole... instead of just getting like a one-liner just for the pick segment, you get a whole segment.
Write that down, chat room. Write that bullshit down. We'll see.
Hey, see, Rakai sees my point. This is how you put your local media.
I'm the guy that put it in the show. Don't be like... I see the point. I'm the one that put it in the show.
Well, thanks, Rakai, for that great pick. That was a really great pick. You know what? Actually, though. actually, it wouldn't entirely surprise me. Some of the best things that ever come out of LAST on my side, like the things that are people like, oh, Noah thought of blah, 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 or showed us blah, blah. The majority of the best ones of those came from Rikai to begin with.
Yeah, and
like the YubiKey segment, the thing I still get emails about to this day, even though it was like, you know, a year ago, I still people are emailing me being like, oh, I pulled up the YubiKey segment. There's not a how-to guide anywhere else on the internet, and this is really great, blah, blah, blah.
See what happened there? You see what happened there?
I didn't come up with that. Rikai did.
You answered a problem that people have, Noah.
I guess, yeah.
You answered. You see, the people have a problem.
Now Rikai's correcting my spelling, so I'm done with him.